this we can say, suppose we have now four coins we have tossed, and now if you have asked how many will be heads, so how we can say there are five possibilities. Either there will be zero heads, or one head, or two heads, or three heads, or four heads. These are the four possibilities, and this total number of possible outcomes we will take as x. So x is just a variable, you can say, where x is number of heads. You can take it as tails also. So x is number of heads, and its probability we will write as p of x, the probability of x. And how to get this probability is very beautiful way. The probability formula is just p of x is n of x upon n of s. Now what is x and what is s? X is just this part, how many possible number of outcomes will be there in this set, and s means sample space, or you can say it as universal set, and it will be number of elements in universal set. It will be the number of outcomes without any condition. So that will be in denominator. We will see that further. So let's solve this question first. Tickets numbered 1 to 20 are mixed up. Then a ticket is drawn at random. What is the probability that the ticket drawn has a number which is multiple of 3 or 5? Now this is a really very basic question, because whatever the mixture is of 1 to 20 numbers, it does not depend how many times we have mixed that, or how many times we have done that. It is not important. What is important that we are taking randomly one card, and that card have to be the multiple of 3 or 5. So either it will be 3, multiple of 3, or it will be multiple of 5. Can it be multiple of both? Yes, it can be multiple of both, because there is multiple of 3 and 5 both, which is less than 20. So it can be possible in this case. So we have to think for that also. So till 20, there are 6 multiples of 3, and there are 4 multiples of 5, including 20 also, because tickets are numbered from 1 to 20. So there are 6 tickets which are numbered, which are multiple of 3, and 4 tickets will be there which are multiple of 5. But here is one problem, that there will be one ticket which will be multiple of 3 also and 5 also. That is counted in both parts, in 6 also and 4 also. So we will subtract that one card, that is numbered 15. 15 numbered card, it will be counted double. So we will write, we will subtract that one card, and the total will be here 9. So there are such 9 possible ways that we can draw a card which is multiple of 3 or 5. But we have to find the probability. So we will take this 9 as n of x, let's say. Let's take x as a variable which is multiple of 3 or 5. And we need to find p of x. So it will be n of x upon n of s. But what is n of s? N of s will be total possible outcomes which are possible. So there are 20 cards. So n of s will be 20, because there are 20 possible ways we can, 20 possible outcomes will be there when we draw a card from that 20 cards. Without any condition it is, because it is universal set or sample size, sample space, which have all possible outcomes without condition. So it will be n of x, that is 9 and 20. So it will be 9 by 20. And this is the way we can solve this. And this is the second question for that. A bag contains 2 red, 3 green, 2 blue balls. 2 balls are drawn at random. What is the probability that none of the ball is blue? Now, even if there are many number of balls, whatever the types of balls, red ball, green ball, blue ball, small ball, large ball, that types are not important. We have to only focus for what the condition is given. Here the condition is given for blue ball. So we will make two parts only, the balls which are blue and balls which are not blue. So these are two groups. And what we will take, the required probability, or the balls which are satisfying, which means here balls which are blue, that we will take in numerator, that is two balls. here, and the total number of balls, in all groups, whether it is satisfying or not satisfying, that we will take in denominator. So it will be 7 here. So the probability here will be 2/7. We can solve this by proper writing also, but I am not showing that writing here. Okay, this is the third question. What is the probability of getting a sum, or getting a sum at least 9 from throws of 2 dice? Okay, how we can solve this question now? There are 2 dice, so there will be 6 raised to 2, so 2 possible outcomes. 6 raised to 2, that is 36 possible outcomes will be there. We can write down that 1 1 1 2 1 3 till 6 6. Don't go like 1 6 1 7. We will just stop on 6 only. Now, okay, the probability we have to take of this. So first we have to find such outcomes which will add up to at least 9. So instead of taking the probability of at least 9, we will take the remaining part, which is not, which is less than 9, because it will be easy. So first minimum will be addition of 2, that is 1, 1. Then there will be addition of 3, that will be 1, 2 or 2, 1. Then there will be addition of, then addition of 4 is also possible, and that addition by 2 integers on dice only. We cannot go beyond 6. So that addition can be 1, 3, 3, 1, or also 2, 2. Then addition of 5 is also possible, that we can get as 1, 4. Then 4, 1. This is 1, 4, 1. And then 3, 2 or 2, 3. Then addition of 6 is possible, and it will be of 1, 5, 5, 1, 4, 2, 2, 4 and 3, 3. Then addition of 7 will be of 1, 6, 2, 5, 3, 4, 4, 3, 5, 2, 6, 1. You can take in any sequence, it doesn't matter here. Just a minute. Now the addition of 8, so it will be 1, 7. Okay, you can observe now here is only 1, here are 2 outcomes, here are 3 outcomes, here are 4 outcomes, here are 5, here are 6. So here will be 7 outcomes. So I'm not writing all those 7 outcomes. So these are the outcomes which are, which gets addition less than 9. But what we need? At least 9. So if we take the all possible outcomes, what is the total number of outcomes? It is 36, because there are 2 dices. So we will take 6 raised to n, that is here 6 raised to 2, it is 36 outcomes. Out of that, these outcomes are not getting satisfied. So we will take that first 1 plus 2 plus 3. So it will be of addition 28. The addition will be here 28. So 28 outcomes are there which are not adding at least 9. So if we subtract this, we will get 8. So there are only 8 outcomes which are giving addition at least 9. So either you can solve in this way, or there will be one more way that we will just see that outcomes which are giving at least 9. So instead of all this, we will take such outcomes which are giving addition 9, addition 10, addition 11 and addition 12. So we can get their addition, and then just that will be the answer. Okay, this is the some basic questions about probability. Then we have seen this at the beginning only, that if there are 4 coins, then there will be 5 possible outcomes related to heads. There will be 0 number of heads, there will be 1 number of heads, 2 number of heads, 3 number of heads, 4 number of heads. And to get the probabilities, we will get satisfying outcomes in the numerator and total possible outcomes in the denominator. Now, either you can count 1 by 1, it is easy for 4 coins. But let's generalize for n number of coins. For n number of coins, satisfying outcomes will be n CR, NCR. It is actually here X. So instead of N, I will take here X. Oh, it is R, not C. XCR, that is X choose R, and in the denominator we can take 2 raised to X. 2 raised to X we can take. Okay, if you don't know what this is in numerator, it is X choose R, and formula for that is, I'm writing here, X choose R is just X factorial upon R factorial into X minus R factorial. Okay, so by this we can get the value of P of X. And for this, instead of using this symbol or this part, you can use Pascal's triangle also, fourth line of Pascal's triangle, because there are four points. You can use the fourth line of Pascal's triangle, fourth row. So it will be 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. And in the denominator, we will write 2 raised to X. What is X here? It is 4. Total number of points. So it is 2 raised to 4, which is 16. So this will be the probability distribution of 4 coins to get number of heads. This table is known as probability distribution. So let's move forward. Suppose this is the probability distribution, and let's take one new variable Y, which is number of heads less than 3. Number of heads less than 3. Now, if I want to find the probability of X satisfying Y, A, the new variable A, I forgot to write what is A. A is less than 2. Okay, just understand that value of X will be less than 2 in the variable A. Okay. There are 4 charts. Let me see that. Okay, so Y is the variable which is restricting the sample size. What it means, sample size here is 16. There are 16 possible total number of outcomes. Total number of outcomes are 16. But Y is restricting that sample size. What it is saying that the outcomes or number of heads must be less than 3. So we cannot take number of heads or 3 number of heads, and also we cannot take 4 number of heads. So these 3 we are cancelling. So this cancelling part is known as conditional probability, that we are just restricting the sample size. We are restricting the sample size and then working on this. Suppose I normally take without restricting, suppose I take probability of A, then what will be probability of A? It is less than 2. So less than 2, there are only these two parts, 0 and 1. So their addition, 1 by 16 plus 4 by 16 will be 5 by 16. So that will be the value of probability of variable A. But when I am saying probability of A satisfying Y, what means by A satisfying Y? That the outcomes must satisfy A. We have to find the probability of satisfying A when it is actually satisfied in Y. So we are restricting the sample size with Y. Instead of taking N of S in the denominator, we will take N of Y in the denominator. Now, in the numerator, what we should take? Because we cannot take just N of A, that number of elements in A, or here summation of P of X. So we cannot take that here, because if we take that, it is just showing for everything this, for all these 4 outcomes. Okay, it is coming same for both here. Even if you restrict the sample space or not, it is coming same. So I'm just changing question here. Instead of saying less than 2, I'm saying here more than one. Okay, now it will be clear. When we say more than 1 with the sample space, then it will include from 2 to 4 it will include. But when we are restricting the sample size with the set Y, or we can say the variable Y, what is Y? It is actually less than 3. So it means we are restricting it to 3. We cannot go beyond 3. So when we are saying more than 1, it also cannot go beyond 2 because it is restricted here with the number 3. So how we can write it here? It also satisfied Y and also satisfied A. So we can say it is O instead of N. It should be here P, probability of Y, not N. Okay. Now in the numerator we can say it is also satisfying Y and also satisfying A. So we can say that probability should satisfy A intersection Y. Okay, that sets can be anything. You can take A and B, X and Y, it can be anything. Just in the numerator we will take intersection of two sets, and in the denominator we will take the probability of that set which is already given. Okay, it is written here actually. The meaning of X satisfies Y is nothing but X given that Y is already happened. And it is also written in the simpler way as probability of X given that Y. And the formula for that, what we have seen now, just the intersection of these two sets, probability of X union, intersection. X intersection Y. And in the denominator, we will take the probability of that event which is already given, which is already happened or which is satisfied previously, that we will take in denominator. So we will take here probability of Y. Same for we can write probability of Y given that X. It will be probability of Y intersection X upon probability of X. So just change the variables. Now here is one thing that you can see. Here is X intersection Y and here is Y intersection X. Suppose there are two sets, let's say this is sample size, and there are two sets X and Y. This is X and it is intersected with Y. So the intersection part is common. That will be same whether X is intersected with Y or Y is intersected with X. So we can say probability of X intersection Y is just same as probability of Y intersection is, because that two sets will be exactly same. That two sets will be exactly same. So this will be also same. And now just remember what we have written here, probability of X intersection Y. Now what I'm going to do, I'm equating this equation with this equation. How I can equate? I can just multiply this equation by probability of Y on both sides, so that this probability of Y and this probability of Y will get cancelled, and I will have here probability of X intersection Y. And it is same here, I can substitute this equation here, so that I will get, I'm writing here only, let me get eraser, I forgot to add one empty slide. Okay, so what we can write here, that probability of Y given that X is nothing but probability of Y intersection X, which is just this part, probability of X intersection, X given that Y, into probability of Y and upon probability of X. So this will be the, again, next formula for conditional probability, including conditional probability. So in the formula also there is conditional probability. So just comparison between two conditional probabilities we can get here. Okay, now the conditional probability means just restricting sample size. We have seen this. Suppose there is sample size of prime numbers, SI is prime number. So this S is known as universal set or sample space, and there is one more set on which we are studying. Suppose we are taking any research, and for that research we are restricting, we are taking this sample size of prime numbers, and we are working for set A. That is, A is ending with 3 or 7. Actually this is not the topic of research actually, but let's suppose that this is our topic of research, and we want to list down all possible outcomes for this, all possible outcomes for this, but it will be very, very difficult. Even if you are using any software like Python, any language, if you are using, it will be very difficult, almost impossible to list down all prime numbers ending with 3 or 7, because there are infinitely many prime numbers. So to do a study, what we can do, we can restrict the sample size. How we can restrict? Let's say I am taking the new sample, new sample space x, where x will be just the element of sample size only, sample space only, but I will restrict that to 1000. I will restrict that to 1000, and then I will use that here. So instead of saying a belongs to s, I will say a belongs to x. Like this, I can restrict the sample size and work on any requirements on what I want to work. So conditional probability can be used there. Okay, this we have seen now, that probability of x given that y is nothing but probability of x intersection y upon probability of y. But when x and y are independent events. Now what is meaning of independent events? That suppose two events are there whose happening or not happening is not dependent on each other. Let's take one event as I passed in the exam, and the other event as sun rises in the east. So there is no relation between these two variables, that whether I pass or not in exam, it doesn't change whether the sun will rise in east or west. So these two events are independent. And when these are just extreme possibilities, but when there are two such events which are independent of each other, independent of happening of each other, then we can just say probability of x given that y is nothing but probability of x, because whether the y is happened or not, it is not depend, it is not affecting x. So the probability will remain same. So for that we will take this concept, that probability of x intersection y when they are independent, then it will be just multiplication of their respective probabilities. And then we can come to know that probability of x given that y is nothing but p of x. This will be important for the next part which we are going to see, that is Monty Hall problem. Okay, now it's time to see Monty Hall problem. But for that I need to get the another PPT of Monty Hall problem. So I'm just stopping the sharing screen and again restart sharing screen. Oh, there it is.
Okay, I think Omkar sir has some issue in the mobile, I guess. So he will be back in 2 to 3 minutes. So please wait for just 2 to 3 minutes and he'll be back.
Okay, sorry for that. I will start sharing screen again. Okay, I hope many of you have listened about Monty Hall problem previously. What is the Monty Hall problem? This is the question. Just read this question first and think on this question, how we can move further. Okay, the question is about three doors. There are three doors. Behind any one door, the person Monty Hall will keep a car and a dream car. And behind any other two doors, he will keep just any other thing which is not valuable. Here in that program, in the program of Monty Hall, he put the goods there. So I have written here goods, but nothing about goat or car. Just to select the correct door, and to select to stay on the selected door or not to stay on that concept this question is there. So I have assumed that you have read this question. Now I am starting with this question. There are many ways to solve this question, to think on this question. There are many ways. So first we have learned the probability. So I will show using the probability only, conditional probability. So we have seen this formula for probability of x given that y. X given that y will be probability of x intersection y upon y. And we have also derived this part. We have also derived this previously. The relation between conditional probabilities of this same variable when x given that y is there and in other side y is given that x. Now what we will do, we will take x and y as two variables like this. Okay, instead of x and y I have taken here a and b. So a is selected door have a car, selected door have a car, and Monty Hall have opened the second door. So I have assumed here I have selected door number one. You can select any one door, but I have taken event A as I have selected door number one and Monty Hall have opened door number two. So this is the door I have selected and this is the door Monty Hall have opened. Now what is the probability that the car is behind door number one? So that will be probability of A. Probability of A, the car will be behind door number one and it will be one out of three because there are three doors and out of that three doors he can put car behind any one door. So probability of A will be 1/3. Now the probability of B, probability of B will be, what is B? Monty Hall opened door two from closed doors. Now there are actually three doors, but whatever door I will open, closed doors will be only two. So out of two, he will open any one door. So probability of B will be 1/2. Now here, what is the meaning of these conditional parts? What is B given that A and what is A given that B? That B given that A means Monty Hall have opened door number two, given that I have already opened door number one. Suppose I have not opened the door number one, then what will the probability of that? 1/3, because no one knows which door I can open and I have selected, and no one knows which door will Monty Hall will open after that. So before selecting the door, there are three possibilities. So it will be 1/3, but here it is given that A is already happened. And what is A? I have already selected door number one. And after that, Monty Hall is opening the door. So if I have selected door number one, he have only two choices. Either he can open door number three or door number one. So this value, probability of B given that A, that is he is opening door number two, knowing that I have opened door number one, is 1/2. And this will be the value of it. We can calculate probability of A given that B from it. But what is A given that B? That probability of having the car behind selected door when Monty Hall have opened door number two, that we are interested in. That's what the Monty Hall problem is actually. If you read the question, what will you choose to stay or switch? What it means that let's take here three doors. Oh, where that gone? Okay, here it is. Okay, so probability of A is 1/3, B is 1/2, and B by A, that is B given that A is 1/2. What I was talking, I just get forget it. Okay, so what we are interested in, whether I should stay on this door or I should switch on another door. Suppose I choose to stay, then what is the probability that I will be? Or suppose I decide to switch, then I should switch on door number three. Then what is the probability that car is behind door number three? For that, I want to check when I have selected the door number 1 and Monty Hall have opened door number 2, then what is the probability? That is probability of A given that B. That's why we are finding probability of A given that B. It will be difficult to understand at first because we directly move towards the conditional probability. But after this, when I show more different methods, it will be easy to understand. And then again, we will come back to conditional probability. And this we can calculate very easily, that probability of B given that A is 1 by 2, probability of A is 1 by 3, probability of B is 1 by 2. This will get cancelled. So A given that B's probability is 1 by 3. It is 1 by 3. And you can see here probability of A and probability of A given that B is exactly same. And also probability of B and probability of B given that A is exactly same. A few times before we have discussed this. If probability of B given that A and probability of B is same, it means they are independent events. They are independent events. And you can see that here also both are independent events. Whether I have selected door number 1, it doesn't apply that, it doesn't mean that Monty Hall will open door number 2. He can open door number 3 also. So the action by Monty Hall is not depend on which door I have selected. It is not dependent on that. So these two events are independent. So we can say probability of A given that B and probability of A will remain same only. So actually there is no need to find these parts also. We can directly conclude from here only that if two events are independent, then these probabilities will be same. So this is just my thought that, oh, I have typed that also. I just forgot it. I typed that, so I have written here. Okay, this is my thought only, that Monty Hall problem in here, these two events are independent. I can be wrong here. This is just my thought because two probabilities are same here. So I thought these are independent. But you can say that it is dependent. You can say it is dependent also because if I select door number 1, then Monty Hall have no choice to open door number 1. He will open from 2 or 3 only. If I select door number 2, then he cannot open door number 2. He have only choice of 1 and 3. So you can say it is dependent also. But according to me, it should be independent because probabilities are coming same. I don't know whether this is correct or not. If you know anything about this, you can tell that. Okay, this is only my one thought, that it is independent. Okay, now I am
sir, going to show. I have a small doubt, sir.
Oh, okay, yes.
Yes, sir, I am Imran.
Yes.
So my doubt is that you showed us that if two events A and B are independent, then P of A given B, A conditioned on B is equal to B.
Yes.
But how can we say that if P of A given B is equal to B, then A and B are two independent events?
Oh, yes. That's why only I am saying that this is just my thought that it should be independent. I am not sure about that, whether it is dependent or not.
Oh, okay, sir. Sure. Okay. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I am showing two more ways, or some more ways that we can see Monty Hall problem easily. So here is Monty Hall. He is here to deal, and here are three doors. Oh, this was actually the first slide. Okay. To understand the question, so there are three doors. Out of that, we have to select any one door, and behind that three doors, there is one car and two goats. So suppose I have selected door number 1, then Monty Hall will open any one door from 2 or 3 and he will remove goat from that. Obviously, he is the organizer. So he will know behind which door there is car. So he will not open that door behind there is a car. So he will always take out goat from that. So I have selected door number 1. So I have two choices, either to open the same door, I have selected door number 1 only, that is to stay on the same door, or I have the another choice to move on door number 3. Instead of door number 1, I have the another choice to move on door number 3 or to switch to door number 3. Now on what basis I should decide this? So for that we have to say this now. Let's move forward. Suppose I have selected door number 1. And the probability of car behind that door is just 1 upon 3. Now what it means? What it means that the probability of having car not behind door number 1 is 2 upon 3. And just now there are two groups. One group that the car is behind selected door, and the another group of car is having behind not selected door. That is this part. And the probability of that will be 2 upon 3. Now Monty Hall will come and he will open any one door from the selected door. So let's suppose he will open door number 2. And he will remove board from that door. What it means that I have now two parts, that selected door part and non-selected doors part. So nothing is happened in selected doors. So the probability of selected doors will remain same. What will change? Okay, I think it can be because here is rain. So there can be voice lag. Okay, so everything is happened in the set of not selected doors, but nothing is happened in selected doors, so that probability will remain as it is. So this 2 by 3 is for whole this part, but we know that car is not behind door number 2, which means this probability of these two doors will shift towards only one door, that is the door number 3, and the probability of door number 3 will be 2 upon 3. Okay, it is not about door number 3 only, it is about any one door which is closed between the not selected doors. So it can be door number 2, door number 1. It will depend on what door I have selected and what door Monty Hall have opened. On that, this door will be depend. Door number 1, 2, 3 or what door it is. So here we again proved that the probability of winning when we are staying on the same door which we have selected is only 1 upon 3. So it is preferable to switch on the closed door because there is probability of 2 upon 3. What it means that if we play the game three times, not exactly three times, suppose we play game many times, then one third time we will win if we are staying on the selected door only, and two third times we will lose. But if we prefer to switch the door instead of staying on the door number 1, if we prefer to switch the door, then the probability of winning will become 2 upon 3, that is 2 out of 3, and the probability of losing will become 1 upon 3. So the switching is preferable here. Now let's take one more way. Instead of 3 doors, let's take 100 doors, because in 3 doors it is very difficult to understand whether it is really effective or not. Suppose these are the 100 doors instead of 3 doors, and I am selecting this door number 51. I have selected, you can select any door, I have selected door number 51. Now what is the probability that the car will be behind this door? There are total 100 doors, out of that I have selected one, so the probability will be 1 upon 100. Now this is the remaining part. There are 99 other doors which are in the second part of non-selected doors. So that non-selected doors are these, and or unselected doors. Suppose Monty Hall came and he opened all the doors except this door, door number 78. Suppose he opened all the doors except door number 78. Then what is the probability that car is behind unselected doors is 99/100. It will shift towards door number 78. That is door number 78. So whole this probability of 99% will belongs to 78 number door, and selected door have only 1% chance. So it will really, really effective if there are many, many number of doors, which means many, many number of choices. So it is really effective for doing this. So here also we have shown that the switching is the better option than staying on the same door, because if you stay, there is only 1% chance that you will win, and when you switch, there are 99% chance that you will win. Not always 99%, 1%. It depends on how many matches you are playing. If you are playing only one match and you lose in that, it doesn't mean that this Monty Hall problem is incorrect. If you play many and many games, this is just the approx percentage value, that 1%, 99%, that can happen. That is expected to happen when you are playing for more number of times. Okay, so there is one more way. One more way we can say the switching is better option here. Let's assume that we are always selecting door number 1, that we have said previously only. We are only selecting door number 1. Then Monty Hall will open any door from 2 or 3 and will always prefer to switch. And this is also important. We will always prefer to switch over closed door. If any door is closed, we will switch to that door. Okay, so these are three possibilities. This is first, that we have selected door number 1 and car is also behind door number 1. So Monty Hall can come and he can open any door. We are not going to win because we are switching to door, switching to closed door. Suppose you open door number 2, we are switching to door number 3. So again, we are not winning. We are just losing because we switched to that door where there is good, not to that door there is car. So we lose here because he can open any door and behind the closed door there is good. So this way we can lose. But let's take second possibility, that I have selected door number 1 only. Now Monty Hall have only one choice to open door number 3. He cannot open door number 2, because if he opened door number 2, there is car behind that door. And he opened that door, he have to give me car. So he will open always that door where there is good. And again, I have two choices. I have to stay or I have to switch. But we have decided to switch over the closed door. So we will switch here and we will win the car, because the new door we have selected have the car. So this is winning possibility. Again, there is third condition, that I have selected door number 1 only, but the car is behind door number 3. Instead of door number 2, the car is behind door number 3. And in that case also, I am winning in that case also. So we can see here, there is 1/3 chance of losing the car when we are preparing to switch over the door, and 2/3 chance is there to win when we are preferring to switch to the closed door. So again, it is preferable to switch. Now it is only for that case when we have selected door number 1. If we have selected door number 2, then what will happen? The same thing will happen. We have selected door number 1, so this same thing will happen here also, that there will be 1/3 chance of losing the car and 2/3 chance of winning the car. Again, the same thing will happen if I select door number 3. Even if I select door number 3, the same thing will happen. Okay, the screen is okay, it is visible. again the same thing will happen. Even if I select door number 3, 1/3 is the chance of losing the car, and 2 out of 3 chances are there that I can win the car. So whatever the possibilities are, whatever the door you select, whatever the door Monte Hall open, if you switch to the closed door, it is preferable to switch, because it is giving you 2/3 chance of winning. It is giving you 2/3 chance of winning. When there are 3 doors, obviously, there are 2/3 chance of winning. Okay, so this is all about Monte Hall problem. If you have any doubt, you can ask. But before that, I want to again go to conditional probability. Conditional probability we have seen for Monte Hall problem only, not for any other questions. Oh, there are many stuffs. Okay, here we have seen the conditional probability part for Monte Hall problem. Now here you can understood what is happening when why it is A given that B and B given that A, because when we are switching towards the door, it is giving us the probability of winning when we are switching to third door, and also for first door also. What is probability of A given that B is, the selected car is behind door number 1 and Monte Hall have opened door number 2. Monte Hall have opened door 2, which means there is no car. So there is 0 out of 3 probability for the second door. For that door where Monte Hall have opened that door, the probability there is 0 upon 3. And we have seen the probability of A given that B is just 1 upon 3. What it means, the probability of third door will be 2 out of 3. Again, it is giving us the same result, that when we switch to the closed door, there is higher chance of winning. Here it is 2 upon 3, but when there are more doors, the chances will increase by number of doors also. When number of doors increases, the chances will increase. Okay, now if you have any doubts in conditional probability, you can ask.
Okay, so does anybody have any doubts related to this topic on conditional probability? You can raise your hand and we can unmute.
Okay, I think
sir, I think there is no doubt.
Yes, I think that only.
Yes, sir.
So what I will show now, I will show 2 or 3 some interesting questions of probability that I have created some days before. I have actually shown this question in RAMTP also. I have shown that in RAMTP also. I am showing that here again. So just take these questions. The first question is of probability of hitting arrow on arrow board, or you can take dart on dart board or anything. Probability of hitting an object on a board. Okay, what I have assumed here, whenever you throw the object, it is going to hit the board. It will not miss the board. It is going to hit the board. But I am interested in the probability of hitting in yellow region or the red region. Then what will be the probability of hitting the arrow in that? Just think about this and you can comment in comment box, or you can unmute yourself by raising hand to give your suggestion how we can move further. Okay, I think
Samyak, thank you. Yes, Samyak, what is your answer?
By calculating the area of calculating the yellow region or the red region we want divided by the total area. That be the
yes, the way of thinking is correct. What happens when we take such types of questions? Some people just think how we can count total number of outcomes. So what will be outcomes here? The total number of points where the dart can hit. So I'm just changing the color here. Let me make it black. Okay. So I can hit the dart on this point. I can hit on this point. I can hit on this point. I can hit on this point. But how many times I have to count like this? And we know the collection of points just make the area. See, if we join the points in a straight line, just like this, it will create a segment or a line. It will create a line. And if we join such lines next to each other, it will create the area. What it means that when we join the points next to each other in all directions, it will create some area, and that area we have to find. Actually, the formula for area of rectangle is just created on that basis only. That suppose my one point is of one unit, suppose this is my one unit, and I have such 10 units here. Just say instead of units, they are sticks. I have 4 sticks in one row, and there are such 3 rows, which means how many sticks I have, that there are 12 sticks. How I can count 3 rows and 4 sticks in one row? So there are 12 sticks. In same way, instead of sticks, we will take point and the unit will be of area. It will be square unit. In same way, we can count the number of points in each and every region by calculating its area in terms of unit or square units. We can calculate using that, and we can take the sample size of this large square. So the denominator will have the area of this square, and the numerator will have addition of all that yellow areas. But to get the addition of each and every separate yellow region will be difficult. It is actually easy, but the lengthy part will be. But what we can do, we can take the denominator as area of this rectangle, and in numerator, we know the yellow region is inside the square only. So we will take the area of square. We will subtract the area of red circle, and we will add the area of yellow circle. Not only one circle, all red circles area we will add. We will subtract, and all yellow circles area we will add, so that we will get the addition of these yellow regions, and that will be the answer of that probability. And not only this, I want you to think for different shapes of this dartboard, not only two-dimensional shapes. I'm talking about overall shapes. We can think for three dimensions or multi-dimensional dartboards also, assuming we can throw the dart in multi-dimension. In reality, we cannot throw, but we can assume that. And you can just see, you can just use this, you can create here. Just I'm showing here one example. Suppose this is a piece of land. This is a piece of land. Suppose this is a beach, and on the other side, here is a water with this length. With this length, here is a water. This is a plain side, and this is the depth of water. Now you can take a stone. You are standing here, and you can take a stone, throw that stone in the water, and take the probability that the stone will reach this part or this part or this part. What is the probability of that? Okay, for that you can just assume some power, or you can just think about that, how you can fix that with particular limits. Okay, so this is one question. There is one more question,
sir. Before going that, I have another way where we can do this.
Okay, which way,
sir? Actually, when you are taking a dart, that throwing, that pencil throwing, that
yes.
arrow, that arrow, that doesn't mean that it's a point, no, because it will have little bit like diameter.
Yes.
So what we can do is we can take that area of the region and we can divide it by the diameter, and then we can see that like the whole square, we can find the area of that square divided by the area of that small in the end. No, that point is there. Point, like we can divide it by that, and you will get some. And you can take the greatest integer function of that. Then you will get an integer value. So you can have that in the denominator.
Yes,
and we can similarly do for the numerator also, because we are actually to say that means a point should not have any dimension, zero dimension. But when you are taking the dart arrow, there it has little dimension.
Yes. Point have no dimension. It is correct. So I didn't mean here actual point, but it can hit every part of that board. So to count that, we will get here area, and your way is also correct, and we can count like that also.
Yes, sir. Like in the dartboard, you have those already, some inserted holes are there. So you are telling about that. Yes. Okay, sir.
Yes. It is also a correct way. I didn't thought about that. I just thinking about the question. Okay, Samyak has raised the hand.
Samyak,
he wants to talk.
Yes, sir. Sir, my question is not regarding the given problem, but
yes.
Sir, when you said that many points, when you add many points, it gives a segment, and if you add many segments, it gives an area. So theoretically speaking, can we add dimensions to give a higher dimension?
Yes, we can do that also. See, here is point. If we extend the point in any one dimension, it will give us line.
Yes.
Now, instead of line, I am taking segment. Now, if I take many lines next to each other, I can get an area. Let's take here rectangle. Now, I will take this rectangle and I will repeat the same rectangle again and again until I get a cube or cuboid, a figure like cube or cuboid. So it will look like this. So I'm just erasing this above part. And now again, at first part, we extended the point, then we extended the line, then we extended the plane. That can be rectangle, that can be square, or any shape. It can be anything. Now we have this cube. We don't know what is the fourth dimension we can go, but let's assume that the fourth dimension is inside outside. Let's assume that. Then we can take the points inside also. And this is the way many mathematicians think about the fourth dimension. But let's take fourth dimension outside this part. So let's add here one more cube. Let's draw here one more cube. Okay. Let's say this is a cube, and we will join this part again. And this diagram will be just 3D representation of 3D representation of 4D diagram. It is really complicated to see this, because we cannot see what is the fourth dimension. But we can think, again, if you take this same object next to it, or just like here will be one cube, here will be one cube, and if you just join the respective points, it will give you the fifth dimension. Again, if you repeat the same to get the sixth dimension, it will give you sixth dimension also. You can do it many, many times, but the diagram will look very complicated. Actually, there is one YouTube channel named as 3 Blue 1 Brown, I think the name is correct. They have made the same video on this, where we can think on multi-dimension. This idea of extending the diagram, I got from there only.
One Brown by Grant Sanderson.
Oh, I don't know his name, but the channel name is like that only.
Yes,
you one brown like that.
Sir, this seems like integration. Am I correct?
Yes, yes, yes. We are just increasing its power.
Understood, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, yes. Okay, there is one more question. If you have time, then you can watch this.
Yes,
also.
Sir. We can. We have time, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, this is a Rubik's cube. This is Rubik's cube. Rubik's cube have 6 faces. Then I have just given some points for each face and made some formula that just rules, not formula, rules. Red plus orange will be 0. Instead of saying orange, I said it as anti-red. In same way, green I will say as anti-blue and yellow I will say as anti-white, so that their respective addition will get 0. Now there is one question. Is there any way to arrange the Rubik's cube so that addition of each and every face will be 0? Each and every face will be 0. Okay, now here I am not interested in the centerpiece. Don't add the value of centerpiece, because when you are adding 9 values, red, orange, or many red, many orange, or any 9 values, you will not get 0. So I'm just interested in corners and edge pieces. So is there any way that we can get addition of all faces at 0? In RAMPP, I got one solution by one student. I forgot his name, but I didn't found after that any one such arrangement of Rubik's cube, just different than that. If you know any solution, you can share it here.
Sir, I didn't understand the question properly.
Okay. I am just stopping this sharing screen and I am explaining in video. Okay, I hope the Rubik's cube is visible. I will take the another one. Okay, here it is. Here is white, and opposite to white there is yellow. So when we add white to yellow, the addition will be 0. Addition will be 0. White plus yellow will be 0. Then next rule I have created is, this is green and here is blue. So green plus blue will be 0. Green plus blue will be 0. And then here is red and orange, opposite to each other. So their addition will be again 0. So if I mix a cube in any way, then is there any way that addition of each face is 0? So let me just remember what I am doing. Okay, so suppose this is the face and I want to add. So this orange will get 2 orange. Now I will not add the centerpiece, because there are total 9 parts. So addition of 9 parts will never be 0, because only 2 parts will cancel each other. So that addition will not be 0 if you are adding centerpiece also. So I am just neglecting the centerpiece because they are fixed already. We cannot move the position of centerpiece. So I am neglecting it. And I am just interested in these 8 pieces. These 3, these 2, and this lower piece, this lower edge. Now here this blue and green are there. Blue plus green. Blue plus green will become 0. So that is solved. Again, this blue plus green will be 0. This white and yellow will also get 0. Because white and yellow are opposite to each other, always. For the normal cube I am showing, for the normal 3x3 cube, they are opposite to each other. for normal solved Rubik's cube, not unsolved. They are opposite to each other. So white plus yellow will again be zero. But this orange plus orange will not be zero. Orange plus red is zero. If we get here red, then it will become zero. But it is not here zero. So I want such arrangement of Rubik's cube that addition of each and every side is zero. So is there any way of doing that?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Understood.
Okay. Do you know any such way?
Sir, I think Samyak raised his hand. Let me unmute.
Oh, Samyak raised his hand.
Yes, Samyak.
Yes, sir. Sir, will you please keep the Rubik's cube in front? Then I might tell. Please solve it and please keep it.
Yes, I am solving. Okay, it is solved. Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, now let me start my video. It will be better.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I don't have a Rubik's cube around. So take any two faces of white and move them twice. One, two.
Any two?
Yes, complete. Any complete.
Two. Okay.
Yes, and then rotate from the center twice.
Rotate from center twice. Okay.
Yes, and you have moved from. Sir, you have moved from two ways. Only the. Okay, this is also correct. Sorry, this is a second possibility.
Okay.
So now we have done this for white and the yellow.
Yes, white and yellow. We have done.
For this thing. Other two colors, other two pairs, and I think it might be.
You can try that. But one easy way I got in. Oh, what we did. Okay, I got it. One easy way I got in RAM TP by one student. That just rotate each and every center two times. See, this center I have rotated twice. Just think about x axis, y axis and z axis and just rotate that axis. So I have rotated in this way. Now I will rotate in this way twice, one and two. And now I have rotated in this way, and now I will rotate in a horizontal way like this. All centers I have rotated twice, and you can see the cube will look like this. And the addition of each and every face is zero here. But other than this solution, I didn't get any more solution for this. So if you know any more solution, you can tell me so that I can also see that. Okay, now let me again start sharing the screen. Okay, so these are the rules, and not only you have to think you in this way only. You can create your own rules. You can create your own rules, and you can create different questions. Just let me see. Is there any another part? Oh, one important question is there, but I will prefer to share this question in one more lecture only, because this question is really, really very deep. I will just share the question. You can think on this question on your own. This is actually the research paper presented by me in IMR conference, just with guidance of Bhas sir. So you can see this question. There is a chess board and two rooks. If we put that two rooks on chess board, squares of chess board, one by one randomly, then what is the probability that two rooks are attacking on each other? And now the question is very simple, but can we extend this? Can we extend this to some point? Just like the shape of chess board is square. Can we change it to rectangle? Can we get the generalized form for m by n rectangle? Yes, we can get that. Can we get generalized form for three-dimensional chessboard? Oh, three-dimensional chessboard is also really interesting. I have not played it any time, but it will be interesting to listen only. That L by M by N dimensions. Or you can take four-dimensional way, four-dimensional chessboard, five-dimensional chessboard. And can we generalize for Y-dimensional chessboard? Now, why to only think for two-player chessboard? Because there is one app. This app, Chnes. This app have a setting of playing with 20 players, chessboard of 20 players. On chess.com, there is one site, chess.com. There you can get 4 players chessboard. And here, you can play with 20 players, till 20 players. You can play 19 players chess, 20 players chess, you can play. It is very small board. Playing with Android is not preferable there. And it is not on Windows, so there is no option also. But you can get idea on this, how we can extend this to Y dimensions, Z number of players, and I forgot what it was. And non-regular chessboard. What it means, that it is not just, if it is three-dimensional, it is not n by n by n, or 8 by 8 by 8. It is L by n by n, or instead of LMN, we can say N1, N2, N3. So if it is Y-dimensional, then it will be N1, N2, N3 till NY. So all the dimensions are different. Then what will be the formula for that? You can try this question. So that's it for this lecture. We will see some more about probability in the next some lecture if it is possible to me. And also according to your schedule also. If you have any doubt, you can ask.
Sir, I think there are no doubts.
Okay, then.
Okay, yes, sir. Thank you for such a wonderful session, sir.
Thank you yes. For giving me time.
Yes, sir, that is not a problem, sir. You can take any time, you can come and take a class, sir. Okay, so thank you everybody for attending this session. I hope you enjoyed it. I think it was a really wonderful session, and yeah.